One question that comes up over and over again, Congressman, is do you feel Congress has relinquished too much of its authority to the executive branch?
Yes.
No, I don't feel that way. I know that to be the case. I've watched, and there's now a fourth branch of government that none of you studied in high school, and that's the administrative branch of government. And so Congress passes these reluctant to say big ideas, large ideas, and then they leave the administrative agencies to fill in the blanks. And you need look no further than the so-called Affordable Care Act, then look at the regulatory apparatus that then fills in the so-called Affordable Care Act. I'll give you a benign example from our side. We had a colleague who's no longer with us, but we had a colleague that wanted a law passed that you couldn't shoot a laser at a commercial airliner. The pilots don't like it when you shoot lasers at commercial airliners. So we passed the law, but then we left it up to the FAA to fill in the details. Now you could argue that people at the FAA are more knowledgeable and therefore they should fill in the details, or you could argue, I sent you there to do that, that you should write the laws. So whether it's the RAINS Act, and I don't want to bore you with regulatory reform, but it's really, really important, and it came out of the judiciary, we're running it on both servers. The RAINS Act says if there is a regulation that impacts our economy more than X percent, then Congress has to promulgate that rule or regulation. We get it passed in the House, we can't get it passed in the Senate, and it would never be signed into law by this administration if it were. So there's no question that Congress, our branch of government, has ceded its authority to both the executive branch, in some instances the judicial branch, and undeniably to this fourth branch called the administrative branch.
Yeah, and I think that the whole logic of our constitutional system, by having separation of powers and checks and balances, Madison wrote in The Federalist that they set it up that way so ambition would counteract ambition. In other words, they understood human nature, and they knew that whoever was occupying a certain sphere would try to usurp more power for this particular branch. And so they knew that that could happen with the executive branch. They actually feared that Congress would usurp too much power and be too powerful. They were worried about that. That's why we have a bicameral legislature. They were a little bit concerned about it with the courts, but they're like, oh, they're so weak, there's no way they'll get away with it. But yet, I think if you look right now, undeniably, the executive branch is the most powerful, because when you add in the bureaucracy, they are enforcing the law, but they're also making most of the law through the regulations. And a lot of what they do really isn't subject to judicial review, so you're kind of moving away from the separation of powers. And if you ask the founding fathers what was the single most important thing to protect individual freedom, they would say, well, you can't let all functions of government in one set of hands or one branch of government. They just viewed that as a major threat to liberty, and yet that's where we are. So the executive is supreme without question. Then the courts are next, because they're taking the power to rewrite the laws Congress passes and to rewrite the Constitution. And so Congress, the founders thought we'd be the strongest branch, but right now we're the weakest branch. And I think the reason is that is our number one measure of self-defense is the power of the purse. But a lot of the leaders in the Republican leadership too, they don't want to use the power of the purse. We pass continuing resolutions, which means we're not even doing our job by passing appropriations bills and doing what we're supposed to do. We had the Iran deal, and we did a Corker framework. Instead of treating it as a treaty, we inverted the two-thirds required to approve the treaty and created this mechanism to have two-thirds of both houses to disapprove the agreement. Yes. And the thing was, I was like, I don't really understand that. Senate passed it 99-1, and I'm like, okay, well, I guess why they're doing that is because there's a lot of requirements about what Obama had to comply with. One of the requirements was he had to produce all the agreements, including the side agreements between Iran and other parties. So I was like, okay, I guess that's why they're doing it, because they want to make sure that he does that, and if he doesn't do it, then he can't suspend any sanctions. Well, Obama didn't produce the side agreements between Iran and the IAEA. And in fact, those side agreements allow Iran to self-inspect its own military sites. And so we in the House actually said, look, this is wrong. We've got to blow the whistle on this. He has not complied with Corker. And so we passed a resolution to say that. The Senate would not do that. They would not call him out for not abiding by it. So if you're going to go away from the treaty process to do this Corker thing, and you have all these requirements, and then the president violates it, and then you don't do anything about it, no wonder why you're the weakest branch.
Well, Ron, you mentioned two things. One, that you hope that Republicans would also shine the hot white light of scrutiny on a Republican president, and I know that you would if you were in the House or the Senate and lived long enough to see a Republican presidency. And then you also mentioned, because we were both there, when the president said, I will do it with or without you, and our colleagues on the other side of the aisle literally stood and cheered, reducing themselves to a constitutional afterthought. I would also add you to that mix. If we do have a Republican president, and he or she begins to exceed constitutional boundaries, we have to not say, well, you're on our team, so even though you're committing a personal foul or holding, we don't want the ref to call it. We are the ref. And one thing that frustrates me is I don't see more Democrats. I see one. I see Jonathan Turley, who's a liberal law professor, on the issue of immigration reform, to say, Mr. President, I agree with where you're going, but I so vehemently disagree with the manner in which you're trying to get there that I'm going to join the Republicans and try to stop you in court. We need to have that same resolve if it's our folks that try to exceed their constitutional rights.